Hello class, I will continue with the topic today of fluid and electrolyte imbalance. In the last class I had discussed about fluid imbalances, and today I will talk about the electrolyte imbalances. So first I will show in the diagram that how the ions are distributed in the body. First we will see the sodium. Basically sodium is extracellular, found in extracellular fluid, and very less amount is found in intracellular. Then potassium is just opposite of sodium, found maximum in the intracellular fluid, that means inside the cell, and very less found in the extracellular fluid. Calcium is predominantly extracellular, although small quantities are found intracellular also. Magnesium is just opposite of calcium. It is found intracellular, less amount is found as extracellular ion. Chloride, similar to sodium, found predominantly in the extracellular fluid and very less in the intracellular amount. Similarly, bicarbonate, phosphate and sulfate ions, you can go through the diagram. Now next I will talk about the sodium imbalances. Although sodium imbalances is quite uncommon, only hypernatremia can occur if there is pure dehydration. That means only if water is lost, then sometimes hypernatremia occurs, or when there is loss of sodium as well as water in high quantity, like in vomiting, diarrhea, etc., then the person can develop hyponatremia. So first I will talk about the hypernatremia, and before that I will say that the function of sodium is important in nerve and muscle function, and it is a very, very important ion in regulating the water balance of the body, or you can say the most important ion to maintain water balance, because wherever the sodium goes, water also accompanies. This you should remember always. Then so I will talk now about how the sodium is regulated. You all know, I have discussed and I have told in various classes that it is controlled by, sodium is regulated, or it is controlled by aldosterone, renin angiotensin and ANP. So aldosterone, renin angiotensin helps to increase the sodium retention, also water retention is there, and ANP just reverse, it is the just opposite of the action of aldosterone and renin angiotensin. That means it will aid in removing the sodium from the body. So now hypernatremia, it is a condition when there is when the plasma sodium is very high, it is more than 145 milliequivalent per liter. It is due to increased sodium or decreased amount of water, which I had said that only pure loss of water, if it is there, then the person can show hypernatremia. And if there is a large intake of hypertonic solution, for example concentrated salty things if you are taking, or when the patient is not able to take orally and is dependent on tube feedings, etc., that time the osmolarity or is not maintained. Hypertonic fluids are given to the patients in large amount, tube feedings are also given which are hypertonic in nature, that can cause hypernatremia or increased amount of sodium in the body. And sometimes there are some conditions in which there is difficulty to take water. For example, dysphagia, when the person is not able to take swallow the fluids, lack of access to water, or deliberate water deprivation, when there is less amount of water available in the situation, in any situation, then the person chronically takes less amount of water, and it can cause hypernatremia. So inability to respond to thirst, this can also cause less intake of water. that can cause hypernatremia. So I think you have understood that hypernatremia, there are two main causes. One, either your intake is quite concentrated with salt, or there is less water intake in the body. So what are the symptoms related to hypernatremia? There will be extreme thirst, dry and flushed skin, postural hypotension, confusion, agitation, fever, restlessness, coma and seizures. And the urine specific gravity will be very high because of less amount of water in the blood, and the serum osmolality is also very high. How to treat hypernatremia? The safest way to is to treat is by giving oral plain water. This is the main way to treat hypernatremia, which is very safe. Then next condition is hyponatremia. It is more common as compared to hypernatremia because of excessive sweating, when the person is in very hot environment, due to sweating there is loss of sodium ions also. So hyponatremia, the condition of hyponatremia is more common as compared to hypernatremia. So there are two types of hyponatremia. One is depletional, another is dilutional. Depletional means only the sodium ions are lost. Dilutional means sodium ions are not lost, only there is more addition of water in the intravascular fluid or in the blood. So the total, you can say that the sodium ions are less. That means the blood is diluted. At that time the person can show sometimes hyponatremia. So in which conditions the sodium loss is there or depletional, you can say depletional hyponatremia can occur. For example, use of diuretics, chronic vomiting, chronic diarrhea, decreased aldosterone, decreased sodium intake, these are most common cause of hyponatremia. And dilutional hyponatremia occur when you are giving lot of hypotonic fluid to the patient, and when there is diabetes insipidus, oliguric renal failure, severe congestive heart failure, when there is fluid retention in the body because of any underlying disorder, like for example heart failure or kidney failure, which can cause water retention. So there can be dilutional hyponatremia to the patient. And sometimes it is seen that when a large amount of sugary, when the blood is concentrated with sugar, hyperglycemia is there, then it is also attracting water. So the person can show dilutional hyponatremia. So let's now see what are the clinical manifestations of hyponatremia. There will be lethargy, headache, confusion, apprehension, depressed reflex, seizures and coma. And muscle symptoms, cramps, weakness, fatigue are there. Nausea, vomiting, abdominal cramps, diarrhea occur. And mild hyponatremia may show some symptoms which go unrecognized, like increased falls, altered posture and gait, and reduced attention. So in both cases you have to supplement with sodium. Now what will be the treatment of hyponatremia? Normally the water intake is limited, so that the condition of hyponatremia reverses back. Now next is, and also addition of salty food items, or you can say that use of oral rehydration solution also maintains the sodium ions in the body when there is depletional hyponatremia. That means when hyponatremia occurs due to diarrhea, due to vomiting, due to excessive sweating. So next imbalance is the potassium imbalance. Potassium is the major intracellular ion, cation. Intracellular concentration is 150 to 160, and the resting membrane potential. It is a very important ion to maintain resting membrane potential, and it regulates fluid ion balance inside the cell, help in the pH balance also. How the potassium is regulated, very important. Potassium is basically regulated through the kidney. When the kidney function fails, there is rise in the potassium. Although sometimes it is written that insulin is also insulin causes shifting of the intracellular into the cells. It occurs when artificially you are infusing or giving insulin to the patient. Sometimes it is seen. So hypokalemia means when the potassium is below 3.5 milliequivalent per liter, the normal potassium level in the blood is 3.5 to 5.5. When it is below 3.5, you can say that person has hypokalemia. And whenever a patient of hypokalemia comes, first you have to see whether the patient is diabetic or not, or inquire that whether the patient is getting insulin or not, because insulin will promote the shifting of potassium inside the cells. So cause of hypokalemia is decreased potassium intake, increased use of potassium free IV solution, shift of potassium from ECF into the cells, alkalosis, treatment of diabetic ketoacidosis with insulin, use of potassium wasting diuretics. This is a important cause of hypokalemia. And another important cause is acute or chronic diarrhea, vomiting or other GI losses, which can cause hypokalemia. So hypokalemia, the clinical features will be there is weakness, muscle cramps, flaccid paralysis. Patient will not have any strength in any muscle strength. Then there can be respiratory arrest. Patient will have constipation, and decreased bowel sounds are heard, so patient can suffer from constipation. Next signs are fatigue, abdominal distension, decreased bowel sounds, which I had said. For this, the patient can suffer from constipation, cardiac dysarrhythmias. So how to treat hypokalemia? We are giving potassium, but never give potassium IV directly. It is preferred to give potassium through food, rather IV potassium. IV potassium direct bolus is never ever given to the patient. It can cause cardiac arrest to the patient. So you can supplement the potassium in the form of by giving food which are rich in potassium, like fruits, like some fruit juices. These are rich in potassium and can correct the potassium imbalance. Next is hyperkalemia. Hyperkalemia occurs when the potassium is above 5.5. In some books it is written above 5 milliequivalent per liter. And what are the causes? The most important is the kidney failure. Cause is due to kidney failure. Another cause is adrenal insufficiency. Then less common causes are use of potassium sparing diuretics, which causes potassium retention. And another cause is rapid infusion of stored blood. Stored blood or the old blood, if it is given to the patient, it can cause hyperkalemia, because most of the RBCs are broken down, which will release potassium into the blood in the bag, and it can cause hyperkalemia to the patient. So next is the how to identify hyperkalemia. There will be bilateral muscle weakness in quadriceps, abdominal cramps and diarrhea, cardiac dysarrhythmias and cardiac arrest. So treatment of hyperkalemia will be: insulin glucose infusion is given. Insulin glucose infusion will shift the potassium inside the cells. Also sometimes calcium is also given. It helps in gaining the myocardial excitability. and so it will reverse the effect of hyperkalemia. Next imbalance is the calcium imbalance. This is also important. Calcium is found basically in the extracellular fluid, regulated by parathyroid hormone. Increased blood calcium occurs when there is more action of the osteoclasts, which breaks the bone cells. So the amount of calcium in the blood increases, and also it occurs when there is increased GI absorption of calcium and retention of calcium by the kidney. Then also the increased amount of calcium will be found in the blood. And calcitonin actually helps to maintain the calcium in the body, but it helps to it reduces the total calcium in the blood. It actually helps in bone formation, that means it helps to deposit calcium over the bone, and it helps to increase the renal excretion of the calcium from the body, so that excess calcium is removed from the body. Otherwise it can cause stone formation. So hypocalcemia means when the calcium is less in the blood. What are the signs and symptoms? Please remember that in hypocalcemia the person will have hyperactive neuromuscular reflexes and tetany. There is painful muscle cramps and convulsions in severe cases. Cause is renal failure, which will cause, in renal failure there is increased retention of calcium. Lack of vitamin D, it can cause increased blood calcium. Suppression of parathyroid function, because parathyroid hormone helps to increase the calcium in the blood. Malabsorption, when there is decreased amount of intake of calcium or decreased absorption of calcium from the GI tract. So these are some of the causes of hypocalcemia. So other causes are laxative misuse, which will increase the excretion of calcium. Calcium deficient diet, this is very common. Alcoholism, chronic renal insufficiency, which I had said earlier also, renal failure conditions. So in all these conditions hypocalcemia can occur. So the physical examination the signs and symptoms will be contraction of facial muscles when facial nerve is trapped. These signs, Shofstek sign and Trusses sign, these are a very important sign of hypocalcemia. Carpal spasm with hypoxia occurs. Numbness, tingling of finger, circumoral tingling or numbness, that means around the mouth there will be tingling or numbness sensation. Hyperactive reflexes, muscle twitching, cramping, tetany, seizures, laryngospasm and cardiac dysrhythmia. Total serum calcium is less than 9 mg per deciliter. In this condition you can say that person has hypocalcemia. Then next is hypercalcemia. It occurs due to the it occurs when there is increased action of parathyroid hormone, which increases the blood calcium. Hypothyroid state, when the calcitonin level is low, it can cause hypercalcemia. Excessive intake of vitamin D, milk alkali syndrome. Please go through this syndrome, milk alkali syndrome, because in peptic ulcer milk is given to the patient to reduce acidosis, and please go through this syndrome, milk alkali syndrome. Please study and tell me about this syndrome. Then there are certain malignant tumors which causes bone breakdown, and thus the calcium level is increased in the body. The high level of calcium ions decreases the neuronal excitability, which causes hypotonicity of smooth and striated muscle. This explains the fatigue, muscle weakness, low tone and sluggish reflex in the muscle group.
in the gut, this causes constipation. It also explains drowsiness, confusion, hallucinations, stupor and coma. So this is just the opposite of hypocalcemia. In hypocalcemia there was increased excitability of muscles. In hypercalcemia there is decreased excitability of striated muscle. So this is all about the class today. I will continue in the next class. Thank you, students.